Welcome to part two of the series. This is going to be fire team roles for the modern Minuteman. So I'm going to take this off because my head's big enough. I don't want to block the entire board. So let me take this off. Put away helmet. All right. Got helmet head.
Come on, helmet head. Get it on.
We're going to look at a fire team from the Minuteman perspective. So I guess I need to write on here. So to do this, we're just going to start out with a very basic team. And again, we said that a team could be anywhere between 3 to 5 in the first part of this, but here we have just 4. We're going to leave it at 4 because it's very common, and it's a really good way to learn with. They're not just randomly going to stand like this. This is called a wedge formation. There are a bunch of formations. There's another one that's called a file formation, where they're basically in a line. But for the sake of this, we're going to stick with the wedge and talk about why in a minute. And that's actually one of the most commonly used formations that a military will use. So very important to know. And mainly, I just like it because it looks badass. So we're not going to dwell on formation for too long. But in formation, we want to have a separation so that one boom doesn't take out everybody or a bunch of guys. Or that one quick doesn't also take out a bunch of people. So the sad truth is that people will get shot at if you do this long enough, and you just want to minimize that effect. So we're going to try and keep about 10 yards in between each person in the team. So sometimes you'll have to get tighter than that a little bit. Sometimes you'll have to come a little bit out, but you got to keep your spacing. And that's one of the things that this guy right here, TL, the team leader, is going to be in charge of. He's going to be responsible for that and kind of adapting that wedge as you go. Things that affect that are terrain, obstructions, waterways. So that there are many reasons why, but it's always expanding and always contracting, like an accordion. So speaking of the team leader, again, TL, this guy in general is gonna be responsible for team readiness. So he's got to make sure that every individual in his team meets a standard. Now, the military has their own standard, which is probably a good idea for citizens to be able to do as well. It would be a good, starting off point. But his job is that. It's, shooting, maneuvering, practice, all those things. He's got to make sure his guys are up to snuff and ready to go. So that's just one of his jobs. And don't be fooled by all this. I used to regularly make the toughest firefighter list at my department. And yes, even as a doughboy. So try to get rid of extra pounds like I carry. I would do a lot better without those pounds, but just because you're fat doesn't mean you can't get started. And you'll lose that fat if you keep up your hard work. So the team leader also leads the team. Could you imagine that? He leads the team. Not necessarily always as the point man. Some team leaders will, and it just depends on a lot of factors. But in this case, he's the point man. He's literally leading. He's literally leading from the front. So, awesome. He directs maneuvers, which we'll talk about in a second. Placement of where these guys go, if possible. Rate. He directs the rate. So if his guys are firing up all their ammo really fast and just burning through it too quickly, he's going to tell them to slow it down. And on the other hand, if they're just shooting pot shots every once in a while and he needs the bad guys to be suppressed, he's going to tell them to pick up the pace. So that's just another job that he has. And another thing that he's going to direct is the shot placement. So everyone's going to have their own sectors of where they're looking. Because if they're all looking at the same spot, yes, it would look really cool to waste one bad guy at the time by the whole team. But again, you do that, you concentrate on one spot, all these other sectors are opened up, you're vulnerable, your team's vulnerable. So each person has a sector of fire, and especially when they have time to set up, for whatever they're gonna do, whatever type of mission they're doing, whatever maneuver or ambush or whatever they're gonna set up, the team leader's gonna direct them to make sure that they have their own sector of fire and that those sectors overlap some, so there's not any blind spots. Another thing that I didn't really touch on, that I want to touch on real quick, that I didn't include initially, but it's very important. When we're talking about those sectors of fire, we're also gonna kind of need to use that for security. When we say security, we're just making sure that we don't get flanked from the sides or, you know, up the ass. So to prevent bad guys from shooting you in the ass or, you know, from your sides and flanking you, everyone's going to have their own sector of fire. And again, these sectors are going to be overlapping as much as possible. And this is terrible. I mean, I did a pretty crappy job, but you get the idea. So each guy has his own sector that he's looking at. Each guy has their own security sector, but in the end, there's not going to be any openings like I left right here. That would be a no-no. The team leader is also going to be responsible for knowing where everyone is at all times. Just made a quick adjustment to the board, so maybe we could see a little bit better. I think my lighting was a little bit off. Still not great, but I'm going to fix that. But I got the sectors a little more clear now, so we can see that all the sectors are covered and overlap at some point, except for here we have that opening, so that's bad. Nobody knows what's going on in that area, so that could be a possible area of attack. It's going to keep track of ammo, give ammo where it's needed from people who may have excess in that moment, and kind of distribute as needed. He's not excluded from being in the gunfight either. And finally, he needs to be able to problem solve, because nothing's ever going to be clear cut like on this board. I learned that at the fire department, that you learn by the book, but you don't train necessarily by the book. There should always be something thrown into your training that puts a wrench in things once you have the fundamentals down. So training, very, very important to do. Do it now while you can. They've already tried to outlaw paramilitary or militia training and make it into a felony. So train while you can. It won't stop you from training in the future. It might have to change how you do it though. So you might have to swap over to something silly like paintball or airsoft or something. But for now, get the real training in while you can. And so what does the team leader carry? And we're gonna get into that. We're gonna talk about what the rifleman carries, which basically applies to everybody, especially in a Minuteman or militia type setting. There should be a standard, and that standard's pretty much gonna be a minimal level of rifleman. And so though we have a specific job for it, everyone here can basically fill in that job. So we'll talk about loadout in a second. What does the rifleman carry? We'll talk about what the others carry. Also, this is not gonna be a rank structure video at all. Basically, in the military, the team leader in the military is gonna be a sergeant, just FYI, and hopefully have some experience under their belt. Knowing this, there has to be someone that will step up and take his place should he be wounded, killed, in case he becomes a casualty to the fight. They're gonna have to step up and take the place. Everyone should know who that's gonna be, and it should just happen like clockwork. As soon as that team leader's down, if he's out, he's out. As soon as that team leader's down, the next person who's prearranged, likely by seniority, will step up and take his place. They're acting in his place from that point on during that mission, and hopefully it's temporary and it's a minor injury, but he's got to fill that spot, because somebody has to team lead. Somebody's got to have a big picture view of how can we succeed. All right, so now we're going to talk about the rifleman. So that's going to be the R on here. And again, that's going to be pretty standard level of training and understanding and competency that everyone should have. And I actually have a video dedicated to that in my Minuteman series. It's a 3-part series. Just check it out. It tells you basically a schedule of what you need to do to get to that proficiency level and basically achieve that basic Minuteman status. And then you work on the advanced part of it. But you need to get those hours training in now. You need to get that ammo. You need to get your tools. Now, you can't bank on getting your tools when you need them, because that's never gonna happen. You need to get it now, and you need to be prepared. In that series of videos, it lays out a very clear and efficient way to go about becoming a bare minimal Minuteman. The important thing is just to get started on it if you haven't already done it, because you're behind the curve. It's also outlined in my book, Rules for Thee, which is available on Amazon. That's T-H-E-E. And the whole book is Second Amendment towards this kind of stuff in there about the modern Minuteman, modern protector. So go ahead and check that out. We're going to go into this gear a little bit, just because basically everybody on the team will have similar gear and should have the same core competencies. And what I mean by that is the rifleman is the rifleman. The team leader is also a rifleman, plus his specialty of being a team leader. The grenadier we'll talk about, but it's a little bit different for Minuteman because we don't have access to grenades for the grenadier. Everyone needs these same basics. First of all, everyone needs to have an AR-15 Why? Because this is America. Not because it's America's gun or it's the best or anything, but because it's so everywhere. I would go so far as to say, as for a fire team, everybody needs to have some sort of AR. This is America. The ammo is everywhere, the parts, the replacement, everything is ubiquitous. If we were in Soviet Russia and we were talking about being a Soviet Russian Minuteman communist, then we'd be talking about AK. Nothing bad against AKs. I cut my teeth on AKs. Great guns. So what else do we need? We need to have a magnified optic. I would say at least a 4X. This is a 6X, but if you have an ACOG, they're awesome. If I could do it over again, instead of piggybacking a red dot off of my Razor, I'll probably do an ACOG with a piggyback red dot as well. It's so lightweight. It's proven over decades of service years, and it's an awesome, awesome optic. Very expensive, but so is the Razor here that I have. It's a Gen 2, so it's a 1-6. It's kind of cool because it serves as almost like a red dot when you have it at 1X. And at 6X, it's very clear. So that's what I really like about it, is the clarity at 6X. But, you know, to each his own. Try them all and see which one you like, whether it's an ACOG or, something like a Vortex Razor. You can't cheap out on it, unfortunately. You could go with a red dot and a magnifier, which I didn't like because it wasn't very clear. But that's just a matter of preference and how good you do with that gun. This is not going to make you shoot any better. This magnification, all it's going to do is help you see better. You're seeing better, you're not shooting better. So you can verify your target a little bit better with 6X magnification, because the biggest downfall of the Minuteman is friendly fire. And so we got to be super careful of that. You need a chest rig or a plate carrier. You got to have it loaded with mags. You probably want to have at least 10 mags on you, and that would be between your chest rig, if you've got a belt, and in your pack, as well as in your gun, of course. You're also going to need 10 loaded magazines, and in this case, this is a one-round magazine, because that's what the internet requires, but in real life, you would want more than one round. So make sure you get some standard capacity magazines and load them up. You need a chest rig, or you need a plate carrier. If you're getting started, just go with the chest rig, get started with it, and eventually add on a plate carrier later on. Backpack. Not a lot of people talk about backpack, but I will do a video on backpacks as well. What does a modern Minuteman need in their rifle? So get a decent rifle, Palmetto State Armory or above. This happens to be a Colt, and I very much like it. It's a 6920. It's a 16-inch barrel. God damn, I'm sweating. It's fuck out here. It's hot as fuck. All right. So just get a standard AR-15 and 5.56. Again, America. Obviously, you're going to need a sling. You're going to need a weapon light. You're going to need 10 loaded mags minimum, which, if you don't know, that's going to be about 300 rounds that you carry on you, distributed on your chest rig and your backpack and your battle belt, if that's what you use. And we're also going to need a bump helmet, which I showcased in the first episode of this series. I took it off in part two because my head is huge anyway, and I want you to be able to see the board. To go with the bump helmet, you'll need a PBS-14, which is night vision. It's just a single monocular, so you can see at night, mainly for navigation. You're going to need a radio. I would put that high on the priority list too. You need to know what's going on, and especially, at bare minimum, your team leader has to have a radio. But really, everyone should have a radio. There's no reason not to when the cheap Baofengs out there are. Though it's not cool and it's not badass, you're also going to need water. So have a hydration bladder in your backpack or a canteen or however you want to carry it. I would recommend the hydration bladder. Water will fuck you up way sooner than running out of food while being hungry. You've got weeks. With water, you've got like a day, especially when you're in shitty conditions, less than a day. So water. Now, the automatic rifleman is going to have more ammo. They're going to carry some more. So these are called D60s for a very obvious reason, because they only hold 6 rounds each. Okay, so you need to have that capacity kind of right out the gate. So you're going to be carrying most of yours in your backpack. The whole point of the automatic rifleman and what we're talking about is that they'll be able to lay down suppressive fire so that the enemy cannot pop their head up, see you, and target you and shoot at you. So that's the whole purpose of a automatic rifleman in this case. So their job is going to be to pin down or fix that enemy in place. So they're going to shoot a lot of rounds very quickly, and you know, you don't want to burn through all your ammo also, so it's a fine art to how much you're going to actually deliver downrange. And so the automatic rifleman is not quite a machine gunner, but they're also not quite a rifleman. They're somewhere in the middle, and they use a lot of the same machine gun theory, especially when we talk about modern Minuteman. They're going to have a suppressive role. They're going to pin down that enemy and keep their heads down so that the rest of the team can move around, maybe flank, or maybe even coordinate with another team to do the actual maneuvering and the movement and the attack. So that's their job, is to pin that enemy down. Now, how do they do that? Of course, we got the D60, so they have to reload much less often than a standard capacity. And then we have triggers. These are not true machine guns in the sense of war. They're not. They're rifles, and that we're kind of purposing them to fill that role. It doesn't have the same brutality as a actual machine gun cartridge does, but it still will do the purpose if we use it correctly and smartly. In addition to the D60s, you need an upgraded trigger. Can you get by without one? Sure, maybe, but why not upgrade the trigger? Now that the Bruin decision is on our side, the Chevron deference is on our side, bump stocks are officially not machine guns, FRT triggers start to make a lot of sense. Dickhead ATF is still hunting down FRT triggers in the wild. So though it's legal, it's constitutional, and like a bump stock, it is functionally and legally not a machine gun. The ATF likes to suck penis and come after people for owning inanimate objects that have committed no crimes, that have done no wrong. So just keep that in the back of your mind. I do feel a need to clarify as well. Don't bring bump stocks for this job. Bump stocks they're not for that. They're basically doing this while you're shooting. That's not very effective. It's going to waste a lot of ammo, and it's stupid. We have better options out there. If you can't get your hands on an FRT trigger because the ATF loves dick, look at something like a binary trigger for now, assuming it's legal in your state, because you don't want to get jammed up on something stupid like a binary trigger. Some states do outlaw them, which is also very stupid, but I don't want you guys to get jammed up on any stupid things when we prepare for actual important things. Even better, if there was a sugar daddy on the team, that would be fucking awesome because they could have an actual legit machine gun. Can the AR fill the position of a machine gun? Yes, for a short period of time. Like we talked about the L-shaped ambush in a different video. We have the Mad Minute, in which it's exactly what it sounds like. It's mad, crazy minute, 60 seconds. Of mag dumping accurate shots on target, and so the AR can stand up to that. If you watch burn down videos on the internet, it's very easy to find people burning down ARs. The worst of them do like 400 rounds before they pop their gas tube, but again, that's the worst of the worst. We're not going to be firing that many rounds that quickly for this purpose, and so hopefully it helps to alleviate any apprehensions you may have about burning down your AR-15. Just check out the videos. You can probably punch the manufacturer of your gun in and watch a meltdown video and see how well your gun does. But guns, ARs do really well in the meltdowns. So they'll do just fine with this roll right here. Just don't do like 5 straight minutes of simulated full auto meltdowns, because that's when your gas tube will break. Your gun will probably still be fine, but you're going to be out of commission for that fight, and that would suck. So know the limitations of your gun, which is also another reminder for everybody to wear gloves, because when you rapid fire full auto or semi-auto or simulated full auto, whatever you guys have in your group, it's going to get very hot. Moving on to the Grenadier, for the modern Minuteman, it's going to be very similar. They're going to be basically a rifleman. So moving on to the Grenadier, it's going to be very similar to a rifleman. They're going to have basically the same loadout, because we can't really get the things that we need to fill this role in the civilian world. Everything starts at a $200 tax, plus the item, plus background checks and all that. So even if you pay $200, you get either a mounted grenade launcher for an AR, or you get a standalone. You're still gonna have to pay $200 on top of that. And then on top of that, you're gonna have to pay $200 for each destructive device, for each round that will fire out of that grenade launcher. So you're gonna be paying for the actual grenades plus the $200 a pop tax for each grenade. You gotta store them in these really strict conditions. The ATF can come inspect it. So that's really not the way to go right now, unfortunately, because it's an awesome role on the team. We can't really fill it effectively yet, but you know, eventually with battlefield pickups, maybe, and some loot drops, maybe you might be able to fill that role more appropriately. But again, we also don't want to get stuck into that rhythm of becoming like the big military that we would be defending ourselves against in a guerrilla situation, in a Red Dawn Minecraft situation. Now, a good drone operator could make very good use of ordnance as well. So, but they're not gonna be one of these guys. They would be back, you know, a little bit further behind with security protecting them as they play their little video game and where they place their little ordnance wherever they wanted to place it to help the team out. So what the Grenadier does is he covers windows, he covers doors, and he covers a dead space. Now the best we can do with that is a rifle. I mean, it'd be cool to have select fire. That might be a good idea for the Grenadier to have if, you know, your team has someone that's capable and willing and can afford select fire. That'd be awesome. But they're going to cover those same areas. They're going to have the same role. They're just not going to have the same thump ability. Now for those billionaires out there with fuck you money, if they were to stock up on things like these projectiles, grenades that launch, and also frag grenades would be nice, and smoke grenades would also be nice, because they've taken away the effective ones for the civilian. That would be a really smart thing to do, and it would go really far in the guerrilla cause. So find a sugar daddy. Now, you also have to find someone that will be willing to sell to you. It's going to be a hard sale to try and get someone to sell you, you know, a dozen, two dozen, 40 millimeter grenades if they don't really know you. So if you do find someone that is willing and you have the funds, go with it, but be smart about it. And legal. And again, since the Grenadier is going to be trying to cover the same spots, since our Grenadier role is effectively going to be, you know, covering those same places, doors, windows, and dead space, it might be a good idea if someone's a designated marksman for the team. The Grenadier position might be good for them. Not someone who just has a really fancy gun and scope, but someone that has a good gun and a good scope, but can also shoot it very well. And that would be kind of a good filler role for that too. And if they wanted to carry some Molotov drinks with them to drink, that would be smart too, because CQB is very stupid, especially for the modern Minuteman. We're not gonna get into that. We're not generally there to save hostages. So be smart about how you allocate resources to any kind of CQB close quarters combat situation or scenario. You guys might get thirsty on the way and you might need a cocktail. So it might be good for this guy to have some cocktails to drink. No one wants to do CQB. Do it like the Fed does it. Or like local police do it. The day will likely come where you get your hands on actual true Grenadier equipment, but between now and then, you've got to have some victories, so train. And so now the team leader has discovered two enemies ahead at the 12 o'clock position. No one's shooting yet. They haven't spotted him. What happens now? Check out part 3 to see what happens next.